Folks, I'm going to first talk about the state of the world and what is happening to change the world, then the Indian education system and what we need to do. The world has got three different forces working at the same time, which is going to radically change the world in the next 15 years. The first is the demographic change. The world is aging faster than people believe. The United Nations says we'll have about 10.5 billion people on the planet by 2100. Sanjeev Sanyal has made a study which says it's going to be only 8.9. And if you look around the world today, Russia is seeing a declining aging population. Scandinavia is declining. The whole of Europe is aging rapidly. Germany's median age is 41 years today. And if you look at the United States, it's growing at 1%. Last year, there were more non-white babies born in the United States than white babies. The whites are going to become a minority by about 2050, with the Hispanics becoming the majority. Even in Mexico, the population declining. Africa is growing at maybe 2.6 fertility rate. The Middle East at 3.5 or so. China's population has peaked, and China's population may come down much faster than ever. China's working age population peaked at 850 million, is now coming down 2% a year. China may become older before it becomes richer. Japan's population declined by 1.25 million last year, because only 1.25 million people died and 1 million babies are born. They're just not producing enough babies. And the population of 126 million may come down to 97 million by 2050 and 67 million by 2100. So all around the world, the population decline is very fast and the population is aging. And India's today is at replacement rate or less than replacement rate. Latest data shows TFR, total fertility rate, is 2.3, whereas if you have 935 women per 1,000 men, and you have an application of 2.3, then it will be less than 2.1 as a replacement rate. If you look at the whole of the South, the fertility rate is 1.8 to 1.7. West Bengal is 1.7. Sanjeev says the Bhadralok will disappear in the next 25 years in West Bengal. And if you look at Kerala, 9% of Kerala is from Bihar. And I believe by 2030, 25% of Bihar, 25% of Kerala will be Bihari. We're seeing 100 million people migrate all over India. So all across India, the South as a part of the population has come down from 30% in 1971 to 25% in 2011. Bihar with 3.5 fertility, UP with 2.6, Rajasthan with 2.3 are growing. So we have a problem in the middle of India. The East is coming down, the South is not growing, and the South is highly educated. So look at this demographic change. Next 15, 20 years, we're going to see a lot of tension coming up with migration, especially those people from North Africa who are going to France and doing some wonderful things. The next big disruption is technology. And technology is going to change the way we lead our lives in the next 15, 20 years. Let me take you part by part. Energy. We consume 92 million barrels of oil a year, with 70% oil for transportation. And now by 2030, cars which are being sold at the rate of 80 million a year will possibly be 50-60% electric. And then when we have autonomous cars, we're going to see a radical change. So energy intensity of economic growth is coming down. And you know, right now, about last year, there was more alternate energy than coal-based plants set up. By 2030, 30% of world energy will be alternate energy through wind and solar. Solar efficiency is 18%, going up to 25%. And right now we've seen the Tesla founder, you know, Elon Musk, put up solar panels in a house to take power at 18%, put into storage, and you plug a car, and you can leave on solar power and put money into the grid. So energy intensity is coming down, and that is changing. That means geopolitics in the Middle East changes. Manufacturing is going 3D, printing with robotics. The intensity of employment in manufacturing is coming down. If you go to an auto plant, they're only robots. Right now, Adidas is bringing back all its shoe production from China back to Germany, and it's going to be fully run by robots, fully automatic. So jobs are shifting from China back to the US, back to Europe, not coming to India and Vietnam, and we are in deep trouble. So manufacturing is getting automated in a remarkable way. Life sciences. People believe a child born in America will live up to 100, and billions of dollars is going in elongating life. All those billionaires here are spending money in the valley to see how they live up to 120. And they're cracking the problem because they find that what ages you in the body is a particular piece of DNA, and that can be reversed to lot of automation and big data. And we're seeing robotic surgery come, we're seeing genetic medicine come, and we're seeing medicine being made as per your DNA. So you're going to have designer drugs to make you live longer. And these are going to change the way people live. So the rich are going to live longer, and the poor are going to die very early, and we're going to have a problem in democracy. So life science is changing. Technology has become cheaper than ever. And technology has made Watson, the biggest computer that IBM has got, which has beaten the best chess player in the world, has beaten the best Go player in the world. And today, the ability to analyze large amounts of data, along with artificial intelligence and machine learning, is bringing intelligence to machines. The Industrial Revolution started with machines. The second phase Industrial Revolution started when we had programmable logic, and then we had assembly lines. Now in Industry 4.0, when we build intelligence to machines, that's going to radically change the world. So robots are replacing labor, even for the company that makes Apple computers, Apple iPhones in China. And we're going to see robots come into India. China is buying 100,000 robots a year. And all those women who stay and do all this iPhone assembly, they're going to soon disappear. And technology being low cost means today any company can start up with just $1,000 instead of setting up a data center with unlimited data capacity. And then the next one, which is next change is coming, is in financial services. Banks are ruled the world, but with the payment system coming under the attack, and we are seeing change to mobile banking, and we're seeing change to disaggregation of lending and asset creation, we're going to find many more players come. At the root of, and the heart of it, you're going to have disruptive capital. $10 trillion has got negative rates in the world today, out of $30 trillion of sovereign debt in the OECD countries. And this is driving dollops of capital into fostering innovation. So we're going to see technology disrupt the way we lead our lives. The next thing is globalization. And globalization means we're together, we cannot shut the door to the barbarians. All the barbarians are inside, they're coming through the air like pollution in Delhi. And now with the world becoming a smaller place, with people with $5 trillion of foreign exchange trading around the world, and 70% of world trade to transnational corporations, the genie is gone. You can't control your economy. What China decides, what America decides, what maybe India decides is going to rule the world. So this is the state of the world. How is our education? If you have to educate every child up to 12 years, we should have 290 million kids in school, because we produce 25 million babies a year for each of the last 25 years. 1 million babies die before the age of 5 is 24. 24 into 12 is nearly 290. But we have only 210 million children in school. The biggest human tragedy in the world is in India. Of 100 children who join school, 70 complete class 10. Only 70 pass, that is 50. So out of 50, 40 go to class 12. Out of that, maybe 70 pass, and that's about 28. Out of them, 24 go to college. Our gross enrollment rate is 28. But you look at India, Tamil Nadu is 43, Karnataka is 30, Andhra is 30, Maharashtra is 28, Kerala is 24, the whole of the south is 30, West Bengal is 19, Rajasthan is 19, Gujarat is 19. And UP, Bihar has 15, 16 something, because we are not educated people here. So what has happened today? We have got 10 crore people in the age group of 21 to 30, ill-educated, semi-literate, in middle India, partly in South India, largely in East, who are there in the streets, and soon they're going to throw stones, they're going to join the Samajwadi Party or something, and they're going to create chaos, or possibly get into JNU, because the professor is going to call all of them into JNU. And hopefully they do that. So we got this big challenge of educating. If only 24% of our kids go to college, we are in trouble. And what happens to demographic dividend? We are in the midst of a demographic nightmare in this country in higher education. We have a huge higher education system with 3.3 crore young people in college. That's 24% of GER, 850 universities, some are waiting for recognition, 47,000 colleges, and largely they're all affiliating universities, the biggest disaster, because in the world, it's only India, Bangladesh, Pakistan that have got something called affiliating universities. The world has got something called unitary universities, and the legacy of the British, which makes sure that we can't go forward. Now, enrollment is growing at 6%. Every mother wants a child to go to college. She wants the piece of paper saying you're a degree holder, because there's respect for a degree holder. And that's going to accelerate. This 3.3 crore is going to 7 crores by 2030 as per a FICCI study, and you can't stop it. Even they don't go to you, there are enough colleges that's happening, and all the political leaders setting up colleges, so you're going to become irrelevant very soon, and that's good for this country. So, that's the state of our school education with the disaster. High education, which is not producing enough bright young people, and the professors and others are lamented about it. What should be the solutions? The solutions are based upon a policy change that we need. One, Delhi cannot rule India in education. Delhi is the biggest disaster for higher education in this country. It has destroyed India's future. And Delhi should be, Delhi should stop ruling this country. We need autonomy for universities. Universities decide themselves what they have to do, like all universities. UGC should be abolished, AICT should be abolished. If you get rotten education, fine. Because democracy is based upon individual freedom, individual choice. And the individual freedom cannot be dictated by Delhi. Individual choice cannot be done by what happens in JNU, because they all join the government and they oppress us. So we need autonomy. Second, very important. Two more minutes, I'll just finish. Second most important thing is, we are a teaching-based university system. We need to be research-oriented. We're low in rankings because we don't have fund for research. We're teaching-based. The world recognizes university based upon research output. Education has got two components: creation of knowledge, dissemination of knowledge. And I think that creation of knowledge has not happened because we don't have public funding. We need money for research, and that can come only through government grants. And third, we should have a system of assessment so that we have good schools and good universities for students to go. And fourth, we need a very liberal system which goes away from the capture of our best universities by leftists and ultra-leftists. You know, JNU, Jadavpur, Hyderabad, they're all captured by the left and the ultra-left, which prevent other people from coming in and having an open system. They poison the minds of youngsters. We've got to open them up, break them up, don't give them money, let them die, so India becomes better. So we got to open up the culture and create transparency. And lastly, which is very important, we must let foreign universities in. 3 lakh youngsters are going outside and getting educated, 125,000 United States, spending $10 billion. Why don't we allow them to come inside, set up in SEZ and educate our children? They're our children. These are our children. How many of you have got a children outside America? Every good Indian educates his child in America and says, beta udhari rao, idhar nahi aana hai. Idhar future nahi hai. All good Indians. So is the problem. So let's get them in. If they want to come, nobody wants to come. Harvard doesn't want to come. Oxford doesn't come. Nobody wants to come. So we are safe from the barbarians. But anyway, the top 500, let them, get them in. Let them educate. Let's do that. And we should do that. All right? So we got to reform all this. Last point, which I want to say. Education is going to a disruption, and we have something called Education 3.0 today. Education 1.0 was the classical education, the Gurukul in India, the academy in Greece, whereby you have a small number of children, you had a mentor, you had a tutor, you had a teacher, and he taught, there was a dialogue. It's a two-way exchange, right? Then came the Industrial Revolution. Then education became a factory. You have somebody who sits in the class like me and bombards you with information. You sit down, write the notes, write an exam, and you pass, and you've got 50 students in the college. So it becomes a factory because you have to create people for the Industrial Revolution. You require skills. So all around the world for the last 150, 200 years, we had this one-way communication, information dissemination. Now, with the internet, the world's knowledge base is there, available for free. All you require is a mobile and a data plan. With Reliance Jio, it becomes even more cheaper. So everybody can now go and get all the world's information. There are hundreds of professors who answer their queries. There is flipped classroom. There are rich videos. But the best professors' knowledge is available free to every child, including Kalandi, if you have a Reliance Jio there. I'm sure they're going to have it. So with that, knowledge becomes free. So one part of education, dissemination of information, knowledge, is unnecessary. Now comes, what do we do? And this is what people are grappling. That's why it's called Education 3.0 in the new world. In the new world, in Education 3.0, there has got to be flexibility, bespoke education. I should have the ability to get a degree in medicine with 40% credits, with logic, with mechanical engineering, with maybe Sanskrit studies or whatever it is. So accumulate credits and somebody gives me a degree. Because all of us employers, we look at a degree as something, as a gating criteria, then ask you to take a test. What you studied in college is irrelevant to us because we don't care. We know what you studied. It is almost, you know, not relevant to us because you're 15 years behind, because the professors there are doing something very interesting, not related to the real world. So we have this kind of thing. So Education 3.0 has to come. And for that, my suggestion, sir, is this. Digital India is a solution. Every child from class 6 should be given a tablet with Wi-Fi, 3G, rich preloaded software in the language of their choice, Hindi, Kannada also. Kannada also is there, my friend. It's not only Hindi. Hindi is not only 40% of population. You must respect other languages in this country. Kannada, I'm a Konkani, and I'm very proud of that. I want a Konkani also. So We need this to be given to every child, because if you want to improve quality, you need technology, technology solution. And as far as the UNC system is concerned, with autonomy, with credits, with flexibility, we can change. And if we don't change in the next 15 years, by 2030, we'll have the largest number of illiterates, largest number of semi-literates, we'll have largest number of unemployed, largest number of stone throwers, largest number of disruptors, largest number of people for any country staying outside, and the largest number of people in JNU closing it down. Thank you very much.